Good morning, everyone. Shortly after the Civil War ended, Decoration Day began. Everyone decided to go out at one day. At that time, it was May 30th, to visit the cemeteries to decorate the graves of the Union soldiers with flowers, notes, and sometimes even homemade toys. The year was 1868. In 1882, Decoration Day was changed to Memorial Day, when the North and the South came together to honor both Union and Confederate soldiers who had died during the Civil War. However, the United States has been involved in many wars since the Civil War. So in 1967, it became the official day to honor all the military who had died serving their country. In 1971, Memorial Day was legally changed to the last Monday in May, which is when we celebrate it now. We're lucky to live in such a free country. However, our country would not be safe and free if it were not for the brave men and women who have served in our military. The purpose of Memorial Day is to remember those who have died fighting for our country, and we can also give special thanks to the men and women who are serving now. Let's stand. My country, 'tis of thee.
Today. God, we thank you as we celebrate Memorial Day this weekend. We just thank you for all of those who have paid the ultimate price and have died protecting what we are experiencing here today, freedom to gather, freedom to worship. And God, we just thank you for that. God, we ask that your presence be with us today. God, that you'd open our hearts and our minds so we might receive what you have set before us this day. And God, I pray that as we have gathered together today and the struggles of life are coming in all around us, I pray that we set our eyes upon you today. And God, that you would draw us to you. And God, that you would minister to each one of us at our point of need. God, most of all, I pray if there's one here today who's lost, I pray that today be the day of salvation. God, that they'll come and they'd give their life to you. And God, I just give you praise again for every person here, but most of all for your presence here with us. Lord, meet with us today and bless us. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. All right. Good morning. It's good to have a couple of people who are excited to be here today, our kids. I want to thank everybody for coming out here today to worship with us. Let me encourage you, if you're a first-time visitor with us, to take a moment, fill out a visitor card. It's there in the back of the pew. Fill that out completely. place that in the offering plate in just a moment so that we can have a record of your visit with us today. I know that a lot of people are out of town and visiting family who may not be living or just getting out of this chaos that is this area on this weekend. But be praying for those who are traveling. Be praying for those who will be traveling away from here this weekend, tomorrow. And let's just enjoy ourselves today and as we worship God. So, Travis.
Let's stand once again as we continue. Come thou fount of every blessing. All right, as you make your way back to your seat. Hello.
Have all the kids up front here. All right. So, kiddos, got a question for you. You probably can guess what I'm going to ask, but I'm going to ask it anyway. Who knows what tomorrow is? I'm just curious about what Liam would say. What is tomorrow?
Memorial Day, and it's my birthday.
That's exactly right. That's exactly right. Good job. I thought you would just focus on your birthday, but you did good. You said Memorial Day. Now, who can tell me what Memorial Day is all about? Who can tell me what that's all about? Phoebe?
The ones that passed away during the Civil War.
Okay, that's part of it. Yep. Who else? Miss Easton?
Is remember people who died when they were willing to stay on our part of our earth.
Okay.
It's about a story when Jesus did the same thing with the Red Sea when he parted the Red Sea. Except in this story, he parted the Jordan River, so that way, one man from 12 tribes could pick up a stone and pile them together as a memorial, to remember the miracle that God has done for them.
That is one of the memorial days in the Bible. You're exactly right. That's a good story. What is Memorial Day, Miss Ashlyn?
Memorial Day is when you honor the people who died in the Civil War because they sacrificed their lives for you.
Okay. Not just the Civil War, but anybody who has lost their lives serving our nation.
Memorial Day is for the people who died, who sacrificed themselves for our freedom.
That's exactly right. Good job. Yeah, I think you guys all know what I'm talking about. And why do we call it Memorial Day? Does anybody know why we call it Memorial Day? What's the root word for memorial? Remember. That's right. So we're remembering them. We're going to honor them and remember them, okay? And so as you have fun on this day and tomorrow, you don't have school maybe. I'm not real sure how the school system's days off are now since the storm. All right. So it's basically one more day off of school, so that's good. So as you play and have a good time tomorrow, I want you to remember those who made it necessary and possible for you to have the freedom that you have, because freedom, of course, is never free. Now, Easton's going to come and sing a song for us. Easton? Come on up here. She's been wanting to sing this song for a few weeks, so we're excited about her coming and singing. Do you want to say anything about this song before you sing, or you just want to sing it? Okay.
The song is called I Love, God Loves Me. God loves me. I always love God. I hug you, love God too. I hope you do.
Yeah, good job. All right. Now, who wants to pray for us this morning? Just raise your hand. Keep it raised so that I'll know and I won't skip anyone.
Thank you for this day, and thank you for the pain. And thank you for everybody in this town. Hopefully, on Memorial Day, some people will be fine, some people won't. Amen.
Dear Lord, thank you today. Thank you for everything we have today. Please help the children that are sick feel better tomorrow. And please help the children that don't have hopes, get hopes. Amen.
All right. Amen. You guys can stand and make your way to children's worship so you guys can make your way this way. I think all the kids go to children's worship this morning, so we're going to head out this way.
All right. Our offertory hymn this morning, let's stand, Heaven Came Down.
Thank you.
Thank you, choir. Thank you, Travis. Miss Benita for playing. What a blessing to be here this morning. I hope and I pray that you get your bulletin, see the announcements that we have. Got an exciting summer. Action-packed, a lot going on. Looking forward to that. Got VBS coming up with that. We've got a California mission team coming up. We've got a community appreciation day, blood drive coming up, all that stuff. Is in your bulletin. We'll have some more information to come with that a little bit later. Before we get into our time of preaching and teaching, with today being Memorial Day, and I know that you've already done a lot of standing and sitting and standing and sitting, but I think this next time we're going to stand is well worth it. And so I want everyone to just simply stand. We're going to have a moment of silence in memory of those who have paid the ultimate price for our freedom, a freedom in which we celebrate here each and every week as we gather together. If it wasn't for the brave men and women who served our nation and fought, defended, and promoted the freedom that we have, then we wouldn't be here today. There's many countries across this world where they can't gather an assembly like this and worship and sing and read the Word of God together. And so we have so much to be thankful for, and I think that it'd only be appropriate that we take a moment of silence. And we just offer that in their memory, and then I will have a word of prayer, and then we'll have a seat. So let's have a moment of silence. Father, as we gather together in this assembly, it is because first and foremost, of Jesus laying down His life and giving us life. Secondly, is because of those brave men and women who have fought throughout the couple of hundred years that our country has been in existence defending this freedom that we have. And so, God, we can stand here today unashamed and without fear because of those lives who are lost defending this freedom. And so, God, we just take a moment and we thank You for our nation and for those whose lives it cost for this freedom, for their families who had to grieve and mourn. And, God, I know that there are families even today who are grieving and struggling with the loss of a loved one. God, we ask Your peace to be with them, that You comfort them, that You be with them. And, Lord, I just thank You again for this great nation. God, I thank You for the forefathers who help establish it, Lord. And I just thank You that we can be here today unashamed and without fear. Lord, I ask that Your presence be with us today. Be with us as we study Your Word. Open our hearts and open our minds, Lord, that we might receive. God, I pray that we appreciate this community, this opportunity, and this freedom today. Lord, we give You praise. We give You glory and honor for all that You do. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you for that and standing with us. Now, if you have your Bibles, turn with me to Colossians. Colossians chapter 3. We're going to look at verses 12 through 17 today. Colossians chapter 3, 12 through 17. This is sermon number 14 Sermon number 14 of our verse-by-verse study through the book of Colossians and the series that I have titled Complete. Now, here's the thing about Colossians. Colossians is all about how when you press into Jesus, when you stand under the waterfall of His presence, He will make you complete. He'll make us complete, okay? Too many people in the world, in our culture, in our nation, and even in the church, feel as though something is missing in their life. I can't tell you how many times I've heard that as a pastor. There's just something missing. There's this void in my life. And Paul is writing this letter, and he's saying, listen, Christ is the only way to be made whole or complete or perfect. Okay? So only in Christ are you going to find that void, that whole field. Okay? So Christ is the only way to be made whole or complete or perfect. So that's what the book of Colossians is all about. So if you've missed any of the previous sermons leading up to this, been 13 of them so far, let me encourage you to go back to our Facebook page. Check those out, any of the ones you've missed, or our Vimeo page, check those out. So if you don't know how to get to our Facebook page or our Vimeo page, then you can go to our website, very easy, www.pbchr.org, and you can click on the links there, and it'll take you to that. So let me encourage you to check those out. You may be disappointed, I don't have any idea, but I think it'll help you get an idea of what we have been covering so far. And a great way to witness is as you scroll through Facebook, which I know a lot of you do, if you could just hit share on those sermons. You don't have to sit and watch it all over again, but if you can hit share on that, you never know how it might impact somebody in your friends list. And so you just never know what God might do through that. And so as you hit share, just say a little prayer. God, as I share this, may it impact somebody's life positively, right? Otherwise, there's a lot of junk out there on social media, so let's put the Word of God out there. I'm not saying you got to watch the sermon again. Just hit share and pray over that share button, okay? And see what kind of difference it can make in someone's lives, all right? So I'm excited about where we are this morning, right? I'm glad we're in this text this morning. Last couple of weeks, including Mother's Day, have been some pretty tough sermons, some pretty heavy stuff to deal with from the Word of God. And we talked about putting to death some stuff, like murdering some stuff in our life, sexual immorality, and taking awesome stuff like anger and wrath and malice and slander. And I'm sure that every single one of us has felt some type of conviction so far over the last several weeks, right? Including myself. And so if you're one of those who's like, you know what? None of the sermons have convicted me at all. You know what? You've not hit on my sin at all. Well, then I'd be a little worried, all right, because your conscience may be so seared that you just don't feel any conviction, because I believe that you deal with one of these things that we've covered so far. All right, so God's been dealing with us, right? I hope He's been dealing with you. I know He's been dealing with me over the last couple of weeks. And so I hope and I pray that you've felt some sort of conviction, whether it be from filthy language or anger or even sexual immorality. But no matter what it is you struggle with, whatever area it is, Paul says to remove it, Like get it out of your life. Step away from it. Right? And so that's what Paul writes in the previous verses. Because here's the thing. There is no room in the life of a believer for sin. There is no room in the life of a believer for sin, right? We want to talk about, yeah, I'm a sinner saved by grace, but it's kind of like we're kind of keeping our sin close to us. And I believe that Paul is saying here to murder and to take off these sin, that he's saying, look, quit coddling your sin. Quit calling your sin and saying, yeah, I'm saved by grace, and we are, don't get me wrong, all right? But we just kind of like, well, I am saved, and we don't really ever address the sin. So Paul is saying, look, it's time to get rid of it. There is no room in the life of a believer for sin. But yet, here we are, struggling with sin, right? If you experienced any type of conviction, then you struggle with sin, right? In different areas of our life, whatever that might be. The problem that most of us have with sin is that we try to remove it ourselves. This happens especially in the church. The problem we have with sin is we try to remove it ourselves. And at best, all we can do is suppress it. Right? We can keep it from manifesting itself outwardly. But we're not really removing it. We're not really murdering it from our life. We're just suppressing it, keeping it from being out there in the public's eye. And so the best we can do is suppress it. The only way that we can deal with sin in our life and remove it from our lives is to, as the Scripture says, put on the new man who is renewed in knowledge according to the image of Him, which is Jesus, who created him. So we have to put on some things. We have to put on the new man. See, it's all about Jesus here. It's all about Jesus here. You want to murder the sin in your life? You want to get rid of the sin in your life? Then it's all about Jesus. If sin is to be removed from your life, then it must be replaced by something else. If sin is to be removed from your life, then it must be replaced by something else. Something else must be put on, and that something else is ultimately Jesus. Okay? I want you to track with me, or I want you to understand what I'm saying. If sin is to be removed from your life, if you're to murder that sin, if you're to take off that sin, you can't just leave it hanging out there, right? You've got to put something else on. You've got to replace something else in that sin, and that something else ultimately needs to be Jesus. And so we've looked at what to put to death and to take off in our lives, and we know that we must put on Jesus. But what does that look like exactly, right? I mean, I can talk all this all I want, these church cliches, but what does that look like? How is that practical? I mean, Jesus, it's not like we can go to Walmart and buy Jesus and put Him on, right? It's not like we can do that. So how do you put on Jesus? It's not like He's a pair of pants or something, right? Well, I believe that Colossians chapter 3, verses 12 through 17 kind of gives us that idea. And so if you have it, say amen. All right, let's look at it together. Colossians 3, 12 through 17. It says, therefore, right? Murder, take off these sins. Therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, put on tender mercies, kindness, humility, meekness, long-suffering, bearing with one another, and forgiving one another. If anyone has a complaint against another, even as Christ forgave you, so you also must do. But above all those things, put on love, which is the bond of perfection. And let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to which also you are called in one body, and be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. And whatever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through Him. Now, to be honest with you, I could probably make about 5 sermons out of that text. We're not going to do that today. All right, we're gonna go through it, but I'm gonna break down a few things for you here before we dive in and we start breaking down these verses. Let me just kind of say a couple of things about life. Okay, just some practical advice, or not even advice, just to make it known some things about life. Here's what I want you to know: no one is where they are today because of a single decision. No one is where they are today because of a single decision. Some decisions may be bigger than others, but ultimately it is a series of decisions and events that lead you and bring you to where you are. Okay? You are not where you are because you made one decision. It is a series of decisions. Again, not that some decisions aren't bigger than others, right? I know it's a big decision to marry your spouse, right? But I mean, there's small decisions even within that and events within that that kind of bring that about. And so I want you to wrap your mind around that. Now, with that being said, some of you may think or feel like you're so deep into sin and have been in the sin for so long that you can't escape it. Some of you are like, you know, Pastor, I hear you about all this sin and remove it and murder it and all this kind of stuff, but I'm just so deep. I don't even know. I mean, it's like a part of me. I don't even know how to separate myself from it, right? Take anger, for example. And I've heard people say this, right? You're just an angry person, right? And you've come to terms with it. You don't really like that about yourself, but it's just who you are. It's kind of the way people have labeled you. You're just an angry person, and you just come to terms with it. You've accepted it. And so you're saying, Pastor, I just can't remove that from my life because it's who I am. It's a part of me. I'm so deep into my anger that if I remove that anger, then I'm just going to quit being me, right? And so that's kind of the way we deal with sin sometimes. So that may be you. You may feel like you're so deep into sin that it's become a part of you. Maybe even you've become known by this sin to a certain degree. And you're like, you know what? I don't know if I can put it to death. I don't know if I can remove it. You feel like it's a part of you. You feel like you're too far gone, too deep for God to remove it even. This is why I'm excited about this sermon today, because I want you to know that you are not too far gone. Amen? You are not too far gone. But rather, here's the thing, you are exactly where God wants you at this moment. You are exactly where God wants you at this moment. Not a person here today is here by accident. Everybody is here because of God's divine providence. Now, you may not always have been where God wanted you to be, but today you are. God wants you here in the house of the Lord, worshiping with other believers in this community. All right? I believe that. And so you are where God wants you to be, hearing the word of God that God wants you to hear. And I pray that your heart softens and then it sinks in and it takes root. Right? And then eventually give way to fruit. That's my prayer for you. All right? Calling out sin and hearing sermons on sin is not easy to hear. It's not easy to deal with, but without coming to terms with your sin and acknowledging your sin, you'll never be moved to repent of your sin, right? And so, I mean, people have been joking with me a lot over the last couple of weeks because we've hit some pretty serious sins and we've done it unapologetically, or I've done it unapologetically, and people are like, you know, numbers have been trending down since you started preaching on sin, and that's okay. I'm just assuming that everybody's out of town, okay? I'm still going to preach it. But here's the thing, that if we don't come to terms with our sin, if we don't come to acknowledge our sin, then we're not going to be moved to repent, right? We're going to stay in this state of rebellion toward God. And when we don't repent of our sin, or if we don't deal with it, we don't acknowledge it, then we won't repent it or we won't come to Christ, okay? And so this is why preaching on sin is so important. It's not to condemn people, and I'll talk about that in just a moment. Well, I don't preach on sin to condemn anyone. I'm in no position as a pastor to condemn anyone, right? God didn't give me that authority. That's not my authority. That's Jesus' authority. All I'm able to do is take the Word of God and preach what He says, and then let the Holy Spirit do the work. And so when I preach on sin, it's not to condemn anyone. I preach on sin in the hopes that the Holy Spirit will move upon your heart and convict you and open your eyes for your need of Jesus. That's why I preach on sin, right? And so I just want to be up front with that. And so if you got a neighbor or somebody that sits near you that hasn't been coming and it's because I've preached on sin, just remind them, look, He didn't preach on sin to condemn you. He preached on sin so that you'd recognize it and come to Jesus. It's all about Jesus. That's the purpose behind that. And so I hope that more than anything, your eyes are opened to your sin and your need to press into Jesus, right? No matter how big you think your sin is, God's grace is greater. Amen? No matter how big your sin is, God's grace is greater. And I say all of this to say this. You didn't arrive where you are in your life as an angry person, as a malicious person, as a so deep in this lifestyle of sexual immorality. Listen, you didn't arrive to that position in your life with your sin as a result of one decision or one event. It was small events, it was small decisions, some maybe bigger than others, but it was a combination of all those things that got you to where you are. And here's the thing, and you will neither remove those sins in your life with one decision or one event. It's time to start making decisions and events in your life that are going to help you on the path to recovery from these sins, okay? So it'll take a series of decisions and events to get you where you need to be in your relationship with God. We call that sanctification. We call that sanctification. It's the process of God working through us to make us complete, right? Getting rid of these sins, murdering these sins, making decisions, doing some things, pressing into Jesus, these small events that are taking place, that God is molding us and making us to make us whole, to make us complete. But here's some good news, church. As a believer, God already sees you as complete. God already sees you as complete. He's not waiting for you to get better, right? He's not waiting for you to get better. Yes, He's working on you, but He still sees you as holy already. That's good news, church. He's not waiting for you to get better. He's working on you, right? He's shaping you, molding you, sanctifying you, but He already sees you as holy. Look at the first part of verse 12. He says, therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, right? We're dealing with these sins in verses 5 through 11. Like, really? I'm nowhere near holy. But God says, because you are in my Son, I see you as holy. Yes, I'm working and making. You got some things to work on. But I see you as holy because I see my Son in you, okay? But there's still this process that's taking place. God knows you as you are, but He sees you as you will be. That's pretty amazing, all right? I told you I was excited about this sermon. God knows you as you are, all your filthiness, all your wretchedness, all your impure thoughts. He knows you as you are, but He sees you as you will be, holy and just and righteous. Not because of you, but because of Jesus. And then there's this very interesting word in verse 12. Therefore, as the elect of God. Very interesting word. This is a reference back to verse 1 of chapter 3. If then you were raised with Christ, right? He's talking about those who are born again. All right, so it's a reference back to verse 1 where it talks about those who are raised with Christ. The elect are those who are born again. Now, the idea behind this word elect is the word chosen. Okay, some of you maybe have different translations, and it has the word chosen there. I've said this many times, and I'll say it again. God chose you. You did not choose God. God chose you. You did not choose God. You were not looking for God when you were saved. And if you feel like you were looking for God, then it's because God allowed some circumstances in your life to take place so that you would come. All right? And so it's still God doing the work. Still God wooing you. Right? You are apart from God. God, He reached out to you. He wooed you. And we call this grace. We call this grace. I don't have time to go into all of that this morning. Like I said, this could be 5 sermons. But what I want you to know is as a born-again believer, God sees you as holy and complete. But at the same time, as the elect of God, He is calling you to put on some things or make some things, put on some things or make some things a part of your life to take the place of the sin that you're removing. So God is working on you. I love Miss Edna. Is Miss Edna here today? She's not able to be here today. Her favorite song, and she says it every time she leaves, is, you know what, Pastor, He's still working on me to make me what I ought to be. See, Miss Edna, she gets it. She gets it. And I'm sure and I hope that all of us get it, that, you know what, He's still working on me. Yes, He sees me as holy, righteous, and complete, but I still have some work to be done here, right? He's still sanctifying me, right? There's some things that I've got to put on in my life, and that's what Paul is writing about here in verses 12 through 17. So here's the thing. When you remove something like sin in your life, it has to be replaced with something else. You can't just say, okay, I'm going to remove this sin, put it out here, and not ever replace it with something else. Okay? Otherwise, that sin's going to make its way back to you. That's what we do when we suppress sin. We're dealing with it ourselves. You have to remove it and replace it with something else. And that's what Paul is talking about here. And that's what we want to spend most of our time looking at this morning. So, listen to this list of things to put on, starting in verse 12, going through verse 13, right? So we're going to remove these sins, murder these sins, and this is what we're going to put on. Verse 12, therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, put on tender mercies, kindness, humility, meekness, long-suffering, bearing with one another, and forgiving one another. If anyone has a complaint against another, even as Christ forgave you, so you also must do. Each one of those are important. And I don't have time to get into each one of those, but there is one in that list that is necessary for all the other ones to take place. And that is bearing with one another. Bearing with one another. And so if you write in your Bible, I just want you to highlight that or underline that. Bearing with one another. In order to be kind and humble and patient and forgiving, you must bear with one another. You cannot be humble, meek, patient, forgiving, and kind if you don't bear with one another. I want to summarize what that means, and then I want to explain a little bit greater in detail. So if you are to bear with one another, then you must come to the realization that you are not the center of the universe. Bearing with one another is the realization that you are not the center of the universe. And so, parents, you've got a tough task because kids are born thinking that they are the center of the universe. And so it is your job to convince them otherwise. If they grow up thinking that they're the center of the universe, then you're part of the problem and not part of the solution. Listen, your kids aren't part of the are not the center of the universe. You are not the center of the universe. A little parenting advice there. I didn't have any problem telling my kid he wasn't or she wasn't the center of the universe, right? I told him, I said, look, I'm letting you stay here because I love your mama. That's it. So, I'm just kidding. I wasn't quite that harsh, but it wasn't far from that, right? I told my kids often, look, I love your mama a whole lot more than I love y'all. I'm just saying it. They knew real quick that they wasn't the center of my universe. But we need to come to that terms. We need to come to those terms that we are not the center of the universe. And there's a lot of people walking around in this world today who think that they're the center of the universe, that the world revolves around them. And here's the thing. You're not going to like and get along with everyone you come in contact with. Can I get a witness? You're not going to do it. I don't care how godly you are. I don't care how holy you are. I don't care how close to Christ you are. There are going to be some people that you just are not going to be able to get along with. When people you come in contact with, there will be those individuals that just rub you the wrong way. And guess what? They even exist in church. They even exist in church. We don't come to church to escape that. It's here too, right? Bearing with one another means that you don't make it about yourself. You don't make it about how they rub you wrong, how they irritate you just by speaking, right? You know, you can't make it about yourself. You never will be able to bear with anyone or with one another if you make it about yourself, okay? But rather, you must look at them, you must look at people through a different set of eyes. That's what bearing with one another means. You look at them as though they may be having a bad day, all right? Or they have some deep-rooted issue that you may not be aware of that is making them who they are, right? I mean, we want to get upset because so-and-so did not speak to me today. Who do they think they are? We get upset about that. And we never take into consideration the world doesn't revolve around you, had nothing to do with you. Maybe they got a phone call before they came to church that upset them, and they just needed a hug. Or they just needed to say, you needed to go to them and love on them. Or maybe you just needed to be avoided that day. I mean, I don't know. But what I'm saying is they didn't speak to you. Listen, it's not about you, okay? People have bad days. People have bad days. Even when they come to church, they have bad days. And so, listen, don't take everything personal until it becomes personal. Okay? I love what we do with our pastor's conference, and Brian Mann leads that, and he brings us together. And here's what he says, and I think I've said this before, and I want to say that to us here. He says, look, I'm going to assume that we're good unless you tell me otherwise. Okay? That is a great way to look at things. I'm going to assume that you're okay with me until you come and tell me that we're not okay. And I want you to assume that I'm good with you until I come to you and say, you know what, we're not good. I've got an issue, or this is where I'm struggling, and then you can explain to me why things are the way they are. Bearing with one another. That is a great way to think about it. And so just because you come in and somebody doesn't speak to you, don't get your feathers all in a ruffle, okay? Maybe you need to pray for them. Maybe there's something you need to pray for. And assume that you're good until they tell you otherwise, okay? Bearing with one another is the realization that you are not the center of the universe. You know what I'm amazed at? When someone we know is going through something, most of us will have compassion. When we know that somebody's going through nothing, we don't have a problem having compassion for them. Like, look, I understand why they didn't speak to me because they got that going on, their mind's elsewhere. We don't have a problem being compassionate when we know what somebody's going through. But let them do something to us or be rude to us and us not know why? Oh, listen, we're ready to cut them out of our life. We're ready to be done with them. Paul tells us to put this on. Put on bearing with one another. Think about it. When we put this on, when we put on this bearing with one another, realizing that we're not the center of the universe, listen, here's the elements. Tender mercies, kindness, humility, meekness, and forgiving. There will be no room when we put those things on, bearing with one another, when we put those things on, there'll be no room for anger. There'll be no room for wrath. There'll be no room for malice. There'll be no room for slander or blasphemy. There'll be no room for filthy language. You see what Paul is doing here? Paul is saying, look, take these things out, fill them with this. Get rid of the anger, the wrath, the malice, the slander, the filthy language, and the lying to one another, and put this on. Put on bearing with one another, which includes tender mercies, kindness, meekness, humility. Right? Put those on. That way, if you have that on, you can't put on the anger, the wrath, the malice, the slander, the filthy language, and the lying to one another. And so Paul says, remove those things and then put these things on. But what we do so often, we'll try our best to remove them, but we don't ever replace them with bearing with one another and the tender mercies and kindness and forgiveness, humility, meekness. Okay, and that's what Paul is doing here. And he sums it all up in verse 14. Take a look at what he says. He says, but above all these things, put on love, which is the bond of perfection. Love is the bond of perfection. Love is the driving force behind bearing with one another. And we can go in all kinds of directions with this, right? We can go in all kinds of directions because Jesus speaks so much about loving God and loving people. But I want to leave you with this before we move on and we finish up. Love will be evident in your life by the way you bear with one another. Love will be evident in your life with the way you bear with one another. Making those small decisions, remember what I talked about earlier, making those small decisions of bearing with one another or bearing with people that you may struggle with will help lead you to removing some of those sins that you may be struggling with. Small decision, bearing with one another, not jumping to conclusions. How about loving a little bit? Tender mercy, kindness. It's those small decisions that that'll help you grow in Christ. Bearing with one another is just step one in moving toward removing the sin in your life, removing it and replacing it. Another one is highlighted in verse 15 through 16. So let's take a look at what it says. It says, and let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to which also you were called in one body, and be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. It's pretty much talking about church, right? If you want sin removed, then you must put on church. If you want sin removed, then you must put on church. And you might be thinking, well, I got that one. I'm here. Right? That's what you might be thinking. But here's the thing. I thank you for being here, but you didn't do God any favors by being here today. Right? God doesn't need your help. Okay? You did yourself a favor in being here today. Right? Coming to church does nothing for God. God doesn't need our church attendance. Right? He wants our lives. That's what He wants. And so, and that's what Paul's talking about here. So if you want sin removed, then you must put on church. Church is not supposed to be a spectator sport. Okay? Church is not supposed to be a spectator sport. It's not something you come to and cheer or to check off your list of good things to do in comparison to the bad things you do, right? You're trying to outweigh the bad, so you decide to go to church. And if you're really bad, you'll come back on Sunday night, right? And if you're really, really bad, you'll come back on Wednesday night. But most of you are like, you know what? I'm just a little bit bad, so I'll just come on Sunday. Okay? And you're just trying to outweigh it, right? You're just trying to outweigh it here. I'm doing good. I'm pleasing Jesus by coming to church. And church is not a spectator sport, right? It's not doing something good to outweigh the bad, okay? Church is designed to be a community. And I want you to understand what that means. Church is designed to be a community where we all have a role to play. Everybody has a role to play, which is why we use the word body, which is why Paul uses the word body. A body or a community where we sit under the teaching of the Word, which is what we're doing right now. And this is great. Corporate worship is great. And we need to do this every single week. But listen, this is still not enough. Okay? I want to encourage you. I would love to see home groups be birthed, small groups be birthed. I know we got some ladies who are meeting in here on Thursday and things like that. But for you to think that this is enough to sustain you spiritually through the week is ridiculous, because you don't eat just one meal a week, right? It just lasts you all week long, but you eat every single day. And I think it's good to not just be a part of a corporate gathering, but inside the corporate gathering, there ought to be other small groups where they're in community doing church or doing things together, living, doing life together, learning together, growing together. And of course, that also doesn't have to be held back with age and things like that. I think it's good to have the older with the younger and the younger with the older. I think we can learn a lot from doing that. And so it's a community, right? It's a community. That's what church is all about, okay? And I just, let me say this. A body or a community where we sit under the teaching of the Word and sing songs together and practice the things mentioned in 12 through 14. That's kind of what we do. Here's the thing about church. Putting on church does not mean simply coming to church. It means engaging and being an active part of the living body. All right? Being an active part, engaging and being an active part of the living body. Can I just say this and I want to move on, okay? I want to move on fairly quickly with this. If you only attend and are not actively engaged, then let me tell you that someone here needs you to engage. Someone here needs you to engage. And here's the thing. There's someone here that you need to engage with. So not only you need it, but there's someone else that needs it as well. And I know we have excuses for not engaging. I know that, right? You've been hurt in another church. I get it. Right? I have too. You don't have time to engage. Your life is just too busy. You don't like the preacher. I get that as well. But let's go back to bearing with one another real quick, right? We can come up with all these excuses of why we don't engage in the church, but here's the thing. The universe doesn't revolve around us, right? The bearing with one another. If you want to remove sin from your life, you must put on the church. Or a better way to say it is you got to engage and become an active part of the church. You got to engage and become an active part of the body. It's those small decisions of coming to church, engaging in church, serving others. It's not about you, right? Serving others. And you'll see that as you begin to do that, those small decisions begin to, that sin just seems to be further and further and further separated from you. And yet here you are growing closer and closer and closer to God. That's how it works. That's what Paul is talking about here. So lastly, and we'll move fairly quickly, if you want sin removed, then everything you do, or then in everything you do, must be done out of thanks for and in the name of Jesus. If you want sin removed, then everything you do must be done out of thanks for and in the name of Jesus. Right? This will help with all the sins that's mentioned in verses 5 through 11. So let's look at the last part. I think it's the last part of verse 15. It says, and be thankful. And then verse 17, and whatever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through Him. Listen, you're not going to remove sin. You're not going to overcome sin in your life by making some big decision, right? I mean, you say you want to join the church, we'd love to have you be a part of our fellowship as long as you're a believer in Jesus. And if you've never been baptized, we'll baptize you. We want you to be a part. We want you to be a part of our community, right? And it's not going to be just one decision like that that's going to remove all that sin. Now, that's a good decision to make, and that will definitely trend it in the right direction. But there has to be other decisions that will need to be made. Small decisions, small events that will eventually help you be separated and move further and further away from the sin. You do it by those little decisions of bearing with one another, by being an active and engaged part of the church, and doing things out of gratitude for what Jesus has done for you. And I've said this over and over and over throughout this series, is press into Jesus, press into Jesus, press into Jesus. That's what you hear me all the time saying. And I've given so many practical ways to do this, and this week's no different. The question is, and this is what I want to close with, do you even want to address the sin in your life? Do you even want to address the sin in your life? If you do, then heed the word. If you really want to address the sin in your life, heed the word. If not, then do nothing. Just in just a moment, you can just stand, go out. Listen, I love you. I love you. Jesus loves you. So if you don't want to address your sin, you don't have to. But if you want to, then address it, right? Do these things. Do these things that I've mentioned. If you feel God calling you to Himself, then let me encourage you to step out in just a moment. Make it public. Say, hey, look, you know what? I've not ever made my faith public. I want to make it public. I want to come and let the world know, let the church know that I'm saved, that I am Jesus's child. So I want you to step out and proclaim Jesus as your Savior, especially if you've never done so. So are you going to address sin or are you not going to address sin? How do you fit in with these things that we've talked about? How well do you bear one another? How engaged in a part of the body are you? And do you do everything out of thankfulness, giving glory to God? Let's pray. Father, we thank you. And we praise you for your word. God, we thank you for the examples that we have in your word. And God, we just thank you that you speak to us. Lord, I pray that as we stand in just a moment and we meditate upon what we've heard, Lord, that you would just deal with our hearts. God, if there's sin that we need to deal with, Lord, let us deal with that. Help us deal with that. But God, if there's somewhere in our life where we're falling short, where we feel as if the world revolves around us, we just struggle with bearing with one another. God, may you help us with that. God, we need your help with that. That's not something that we do natural. And God, maybe we need to engage into the church. God, there's people here who need each other. But because there's no engagement, it's missing. God, I pray that you'll speak to our hearts about that. God, I pray that in everything we do, we give thanks. God, because we know that you're at work in our lives. And God, that it's not by accident that we're here. But God, you are sovereign. And we give you glory for all you do. Meet with us during this invitation. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand. Every head bowed, every eye closed. The altar's open. If you need to come, need to pray.